ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors of the ETF Store. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. Investing in ETFs involves risk, including potential loss of principal. Any past performance figures discussed are not necessarily indicative of future results. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate will help you get up to date with what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
All right, really nice show this week. Two great guests joining me. I'll start with ETF.com, Sumeet Roy. He recently put together a list of the fastest growing ETFs this year. And actually, it was two lists. We'll get into that. But what I like about these lists is some really interesting ETF stories sort of come to the surface. Because I think everyone is well aware of the U.S. Global Jets ETF, right? That thing just hit $1.5 billion in assets. It's getting all kinds of publicity. Of course, we also have the United States Oil Fund, ticker USO. I think everyone knows that story. And both of those ETFs are on Sumeet's list, but those have been well documented. And I do think they've somewhat overshadowed some other pretty big ETF success stories this year. So I want to get Sumeet's take on those other stories. I have a few thoughts as well. And then we'll also spend a couple of minutes on ETF flows overall, which I find noteworthy, just given everything going on in the markets this year. I mean, you look at where stocks are at as we sit here today, ETF flows, I think, also unearthed some pretty interesting stories. And then I'll also be joined this week by John Molchan, Managing Director and Portfolio Manager with Harvest Volatility Management. He's going to spotlight the Nationwide Risk Managed Income ETF, ticker symbol NUSI, which this uses an options caller strategy on top of the NASDAQ 100. And this ETF has performed really well year to date. So I'll have John explain that ETF and where it may fit in an investment portfolio. As always, questions or comments, you can find me out on Twitter at Nate Geraci, or you can go to etfprime.com. Let's start with ETF.com, Sumeet Roy.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
Just like with the stock, it's a function of the volume of the security. You can often put your limit order in between those two prices. The SEC is still concerned about how do you value cryptocurrencies.
Sumeet, great having you back on the podcast. Thanks for joining me this week.
Pleasure to be here, Nate. Thanks so much for having me.
So look, not many people cover ETF flows as closely as you do, and we are going to focus on the fastest growing ETFs this week in terms of percentage of inflows. You wrote a really nice piece on this. It's out at ETF.com. However, before we do that, I did want to ask you about ETF flows overall. So you had both a May recap of ETF flows last week, and then I saw your usual weekly recap on Friday. And I guess I'm just curious, is there anything standing out to you at this point? Of course, it's hard to believe the S&P 500 is nearly back to record highs. I mean, if you'd gone to sleep in mid-February and just woken up, it's like nothing ever happened. It's kind of hard to get your head around. But obviously, we can see some stories in the ETF flow. So anything in particular standing out to you?
Yeah, Nate. I mean, you mentioned how resilient U.S. stocks have been in terms of pricing. I mean, ETF flows have been just as resilient. We have about $160 billion worth of inflows for U.S.-listed ETFs so far this year, and that's double the $75 billion we saw at the same time last year. Now, if you annualize that, we're tracking towards about $400 billion for the year, and I think we can get even beyond that, given that, you know, inflows slowed down pretty significantly during the COVID market sell-off in March. So the all-time record high for annual inflows is $476 billion, which was set in 2017. I think that's actually beatable this year, given how strong inflows have been in the face of everything that's gone on. Now, in terms of where we're seeing the inflows, fixed income is actually leading the way with $72 billion, and U.S. equity ETFs are following around $59 billion. So, you know, even though we're seeing U.S. stocks very resilient, we can't forget that it's been a record year for fixed income. Treasury yields hit all-time lows earlier this year. And even after the recent sell-off in treasuries, something like TLT, which is a 20-plus-year treasury ETF, it's up 16.5% year-to-date. Ag and LQD, they're up 5% each. I mean, those are all better than the S&P 500, which just went into the green for the year on Monday. I'll just add that commodity ETFs, they've been quite popular this year also, inflows of about $29 billion. And a lot of that is into GLD, which has gathered about $13 billion. And then finally, on the outflow side, international equity ETFs, they've had outflows of about $17 billion. And that just goes to show that, you know, even with all the risks in the country related to COVID, related to, you know, more social unrest, investors are much more confident about the outlook for the U.S. compared to international markets.
Well, and I think on that note, when you talk about potentially challenging the all-time record for ETF flows, obviously that's highly market dependent. But, you know, if we continue with any sort of equity strength, we know that we're seeing the record flows on the fixed income side. Obviously, you have a lot of investors running ahead of the Fed. We know the Fed is now purchasing bond ETFs, so you have a bit of a tailwind there. But, if stocks are able to stay, you know, even somewhat resilient here, and then you mentioned what's happening in the commodity space. I still think you're going to have interest in products like GLD and maybe even investors still playing the bottom or continued rebound in oil. It'll be interesting to see. I think you're right. I think we may come close, but if nothing else, I mean, we are on a really strong pace for ETF flows, which is pretty remarkable given where we were back in terms of the market in late February, early March. Sumeet, let's move on and talk about your piece on the fastest growing ETFs. And as I alluded to earlier, these aren't necessarily the ETFs that have taken in the most money, right? These are ETFs with the highest growth on a percentage basis. And you broke these into two groups. Actually, I guess before we get into the ETFs themselves, do you want to explain the methodology here?
Yeah, so with these lists, I was attempting to highlight those smaller funds, which are seeing a lot of interest and a lot of growth, mostly inflows, but also strong performance. So, you know, this captures both inflows and performance. And these are the ETFs that don't typically get captured in the aggregate inflows list that are published on ETFs.com and elsewhere, because they're usually dwarfed by the giant ETFs that we talk about, the spies of the world and things like that. For example, if you look at the two ETFs with the largest inflows this year, VOO and LQD, they've had inflows of about $15, $16 billion each year to date. Now, that's huge and impressive, but on a percentage basis, compared to their assets under management, those inflows are only equal to something like 10% for VOO and 25% for LQD. Now, if you look at the funds on the list I put together, they're seeing percentage growth in the hundreds or even thousands of percent. Of course, you know, some of them are starting with extremely low assets to begin with. So if you move up from $1 million to $5 million in assets, that's 500% growth, but not necessarily noteworthy for investors. Now, but then again, if you move up from $1 million to $100 million, like that happened with the fund called Hero, or $50 million to $1 billion-plus, like happened with JET, that's going to catch your eye. So there's two lists, like you mentioned, Nate. One where the assets at the start of the year could be anything, and you're generally going to see the smaller funds on that. And then there's the other list with assets at the start of the year with at least $50 million, and some of those funds are extremely, extremely impressive, and they already have billions of dollars of assets today.
Okay, so let's start with the first list. So just purely percentage increase, no asset threshold. And at the top of that list is the First Trust Cboe Vest U.S. Equity Deep Buffer ETF, ticker symbol DAUG. So that's grown from $3 million to over $260 million this year. And interestingly, there are also two other buffer ETFs in the top 10 of that list. And, you know, as I was looking at this, I wonder if these ETFs are just going to continue being staples on these types of lists. It just seems like this entire defined outcome category is in the early innings of growth. Of course, we saw Alliance enter the space just last week. I guess, do you agree with that? Do you think we'll continue seeing buffer ETFs dominate these types of lists?
I think you're right. We are in the early stages of growth for these types of funds, and we'll probably see them more on these lists. I mean, they've grown tremendously, starting with the innovator line of defined outcome ETFs, and now, you know, First Trust with DAUG. I mean, the bottom line is these products, they've really resonated with investors who want something better than the paltry returns you get in bonds, but with less of the extreme volatility that you sometimes see in stocks. So I think with DAUG, when it first came out, you were looking at something like a 6.6% return on the upside, and it capped your downside to 5% as long as the S&P 500 didn't fall more than 30%. So, you know, 6.6% potential return with 5% downside, you know, that's a risk-reward profile that is appealing to a lot of people who just want steady, consistent growth and don't mind missing out on a huge year of gains in the stock market, as long as their risk is capped to some extent. So, you know, I think these are brilliantly designed products. They really fill a need in the market, and there's a lot of growth to go. I mean, a lot of investors don't know they exist or just haven't yet been educated on how they work. So as that evolves, I think, yeah, the assets are going to continue to flow in.
Okay, now two interesting thematic ETFs on the list, the Global X Video Games and Esports ETF, ticker symbol HERO, which you mentioned earlier, and then the WisdomTree Cloud Computing ETF, ticker symbol WCLD. And something I find noteworthy here is both of these ETFs are in pretty competitive spaces where there's multiple ETFs to choose from. But any thoughts on these? I mean, do you think this is primarily coronavirus-driven in terms of people staying home?
They are coronavirus-driven, but there are also ETFs and growth areas that were already working before coronavirus. So coronavirus kind of accelerated the trends already. You know, HERO, like you said, it's a video game ETF. It also focused on esports, and it's gone from almost $1 million in assets to $100 million in assets. And, you know, video games are a huge industry. They've been growing at a double-digit percentage rate globally. I think sales are over $100 billion worldwide for video games. And that makes it pretty much the biggest entertainment industry in the world, bigger than movies, bigger than music, and neck with TV. So the virus accelerated the trend. People are stuck at home. They're playing more video games. But when people leave their homes, they're probably not going to stop playing video games. So I think, you know, that's what people are looking at. They're looking at it as a long-term secular growth play that's been accelerated by the virus but doesn't depend on the virus. And it's a similar situation for WCLD. This is a cloud computing ETF from WisdomTree. Only the stocks in this basket, they're more related to business than entertainment. The vast majority of the companies and the stocks in WCLD are software firms that help companies, you know, with their digital transformation goals, things like that. They help workers be more productive. They help them collaborate. They provide companies with analytics, cybersecurity storage, computing resources, things like that, that are mission-critical functions, you know, in today's hyper-competitive business world. So these are the type of stocks that were already performing phenomenally before COVID, but the virus has pushed that growth to another level. I mean, we've all heard of Zoom. It's become a verb to some extent, and that's one of those stocks. And this ETF, I mean, it's tripled this year, so it's not hard to see why this ETF has caught up with investors.
No, there's no question. I mean, I think performance is clearly a driver in both of these spaces. Actually, over the weekend, I was looking at performance year-to-date from the entire ETF universe, and that WisdomTree Cloud Computing ETF, that's one of the top performers this year. I think it was number two on the list if you exclude leverage, inverse, and volatility ETFs. And, you know, it's really the same story with video game ETFs. For the most part across the board, those have performed very nicely as well. So no question, performance is a big part of the story. Okay, one other ETF from the first list that I feel like is flying under the radar a bit. I'm really surprised this isn't getting more attention. That's the RPAR Risk Parity ETF, ticker RPAR, R-P-A-R. Any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, great asset growth for RPAR, about $30 million at the start of the year, and now $500 million of assets. So this is a multi-asset fund. It holds equities, it holds commodities, it holds treasuries and chips. And RPAR, you know, like the name says, it's a risk parity fund. And that's a type of strategy that you sometimes see hedge funds use. And it's basically an asset allocation strategy where instead of weighting your holdings based on some arbitrary levels for each asset class, like 60-40 stocks to bonds, you weight them based on a target risk and a target return level. So, for example, they might sometimes lever up their treasury positions to juice the risk return profile of fixed income and bring it more in line with equities. Ideally, this is going to give you a similar return to equities, but with less risk. Now, of course, with any alternative strategy, the reality doesn't always line up with what the fund is hoping to do. But at least in the short time that RPAR has been on the market, it is moving up to its mandate. Last I checked, it was up 5% year-to-date compared to 1% for the S&P 500. But, I just want to add that the target allocation for the fund is 25% global equities, 15% commodity producer equities, 17.5% gold, 20% chips, and 23% treasuries. So there's a lot more commodity exposure in there than a typical portfolio. So you should be comfortable with that if you're going to buy this ETF.
I'll be interested to see just if the alternative ETF space as a whole continues to gain some traction. Actually, coming into this year, one of my ETF predictions was that we would see alternative ETF sort of pick up steam. Now, obviously, I wasn't predicting a global pandemic and some of the things that we've seen in the market. But I do wonder if investors experiencing that 34 or 35% drop, maybe it got their attention a little bit, and some investors will look at some alternative strategies as a way to, you know, either diversify their portfolio or offer a hedge or just try to take down volatility a little bit. But that ETF, again, definitely stuck out because it hasn't been out very long. I think it launched back in December. So, again, I think a bit of an underrated ETF story. Okay, let's move on to your second list. So these are ETFs that begin the year with more than $50 million in assets. And no surprise at all, at the top of that list is the U.S. Global JETS ETF, ticker JETS. I keep saying I think this may end up being the ETF story of the year. This thing crossed over $1 billion in assets last week. I don't know if you saw the tweet from U.S. Global, their CEO, Frank Holmes, popping champagne. it was great stuff. And as of this morning, I think last I checked, this fund is now like at $1.7 billion. It's just unbelievable.
Wow.
But all that said, look, this story's been well covered over the last 2 months. So I'm actually going to skip over that just because we've spent so much time on it. I want to go to number two on the list. And I'll be honest, I haven't followed this ETF closely at all. The Spider Kensho New Economies ETF, ticker KOMP, that's gone from about $113 million to nearly $700 million. What is this?
Yeah, Nate, I mean, this one is under the radar. And this is one of those next generation type ETFs that holds stocks focused on technologies, you know, like artificial intelligence, 3D printing, genomics, autonomous vehicles, you know, things like that. And there is a strong market for these type of cutting-edge, high-growth companies and the ETFs that hold these companies. We've seen it with, for example, ARK, which is the issuer of several active ETFs that have done extremely well by focusing on these types of areas. And Comp seems to be riding that same trend, except I took a look at the holdings for Comp, and it is much more diversified than the ARK fund. You're talking about almost 400 holdings for Comp. Now, that's going to reduce the volatility of the fund and make it safer than, you know, something like the ARK fund. But less concentration also reduces the potential upside, you know, when select growth stocks are firing on all cylinders like this year. For example, ARK, with its concentrated portfolio of 37 holdings, ARK, the flagship fund from ARK, that's up 30% year-to-date, but Comp is only up 6%. So, you know, there is quite a bit of difference given, you know, how diversified comp is. But it's just a completely different risk-reward profile. If you want something a little bit safer, more diversified, comp fits that bill.
This seems like another space where I'm seeing more competition. If I recall correctly, last week iShares is launching several products that I feel like play on this similar theme or space. I think, you know, you mentioned ARK. ARK clearly paved the way here, and their performance has been, frankly, spectacular. But that's interesting. It's interesting to see Spider come out with a product like that, and clearly it's having a lot of success. Okay, there were also four oil ETFs in the top 10 on the second list, which that's interesting just because the performance has been so bad there, right? Now, obviously, investors are hoping to play a rebound, and I will say here recently they have been correct. Oil has performed really well recently, but year to date it's not been a good place to be. The question I have is, we're all familiar with the United States Oil Fund, USO, all of the changes made to what that ETF holds, some of the other issues they've had. How much do you think those issues have led investors to look at the other three oil products? Because USO, as I look at your list, USO was number 10. The other three oil ETFs, so tickers USL, UCO, and BNO, those were all higher than USO in terms of percentage growth.
Yeah, I do think some of the issues that USOs had have, you know, led to some buying in the other products. I mean, they do solve some of the problems that USO has. For example, UCO, that's the one that buys oil futures across the curve. That may have benefited from some investors trying to avoid contango, for example. And then, you know, we saw issues with the U.S. oil benchmark, WTI. Prices briefly went negative. That was a big story. That could have pushed some investors to opt for BNO instead, which is the ETF that tracks the European oil benchmark Brent, and that never even got close to negative. So, you know, regardless of why investors are buying any particular oil ETF, I think the fact is that this was, you know, an incredible saga, one of the biggest oil stories and biggest ETF stories of the year. And, you know, billions of dollars in these products and billions of dollars were destroyed. And, you know, it's really just a cautionary tale. That's all there is to it.
All right, Sameet, just a few minutes left. I'm going to let you choose your own adventure here. So number five on that second list was the iShares ESG MSCI USA ETF, ticker ESGU. I think clearly a lot of BYOA here, bring your own assets. And then numbers 7, 8, and 9 were the Direction Home Builders and Supplies Bull 3 Timeshares, ticker NAIL, great ticker symbol. I'm somewhat surprised that ETF's on the list. The Avantis U.S. Small Cap Value ETF, ticker AVUV. And then the VanEck Vectors Video Gaming and Esports ETF, ticker ESPO. Of course, we talked about video games earlier. What about the other three ETFs? If we put video gaming aside, we talked about that with Hero. Do you want to pick one of these other ETFs?
I'm going to go with AVUV, the Avantis U.S. Small Cap Value ETF. I think that one's really under the radar. It's gone from about $57 million to $250 million in assets. And, you know, I did a little reading earlier this week, and I was actually astounded to read that the first quarter of the year was actually the worst quarterly performance ever for small cap value.
I saw that.
Yeah. I mean, AVUV was down 42% in those 3 months. I mean, that's absolutely incredible. And, you know, everyone knows how bad value has done, especially compared to growth. But small cap value has taken that underperformance to an even further level. I mean, it's done even worse than large cap value. And recently we've seen, you know, value start to rebound, and there's all this talk that, you know, after 13 years of underperformance, maybe value is ready to outperform. And if that's the case, then, you know, it stands to reason that if value makes a comeback, then small cap value should do the best, even better than large cap value. So, I mean, that's not necessarily a bet I'd take myself, but if that's your belief, that's your view, this seems like the perfect ETF to do it with.
I think that stat you're referencing, I'm pretty sure I saw that too. It was the FAMA French Small Cap Value Index going back, I believe, 94 years. Q1 of this year was the worst performing ever. Of course, that's bounced back here recently. And, you know, actually, overall, the Avantis lineup has done really well. You talk about new ETF entrants over the past, you know, what, year or two, Avantis has to be right at the top of that list, along with somebody like maybe Innovator ETFs. They've had a lot of success in getting that lineup off the ground. So interesting to watch moving forward. Sumeet, great stuff this week. Always fun chatting. Appreciate you taking the time. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Nate.
That was ETF.com, Sumeet Roy. I'm now joined by John Molchan, Managing Director and Portfolio Manager with Harvest Volatility Management. They're the sub-advisor on the nationwide risk-managed income ETF, ticker symbol NUSI. This just launched last December. It's already over $50 million in assets, and Nationwide currently offers five ETFs overall, approaching $400 million in assets. John is now on the line with me from Connecticut. John, a pleasure having you on the show.
Hey, Nate. Pleasure being here. Thanks for having me.
John, before we get to the ETF, can you just give us some quick background on Harvest Volatility Management and perhaps the partnership with Nationwide?
Absolutely. So Harvest Volatility Management is a $4 billion money manager headquartered in New York City with a focus on, you know, unlocking value for investors through options strategies, both offered as overlays as well as investable products. And how it, you know, resulted in a partnership with Nationwide was, as they were growing out their ETF business, there was a strategy using options packaged in a that could be packaged in an ETF wrapper that we thought, you know, really combined many of the benefits that would align with the principles of Nationwide Insurance.
Okay, so a lot to cover with this ETF. Again, it's the Nationwide Risk Managed Income ETF. Let's maybe start with some basics. Walk us through the strategy at a high level, and then we can get into some more detail.
Sure. So the strategy is a protective net credit collar. A lot of words, but it's a pretty straightforward and simple strategy that's been used by investors for decades. And it's combining two very common option strategies. That would be a covered call and a protective put. And you do that with the underlying being a basket of equities. So what we've done is fully replicated the constituents of the NASDAQ 100 index. And then on a monthly basis, we are combining that covered call and that protective put, whereby delivering high monthly income, as well as a fully financed put, which serves as a portfolio hedge if the market were to sell off.
In terms of that options caller strategy, can you just explain that in a bit more detail in terms of, you know, what the ultimate goal is here, how this typically plays out? You mentioned generating a net credit. Just walk through that in a little more detail.
Sure. So on a monthly basis, the strategy will sell an upside call option, and that will generate options premium. A portion of that is used to purchase the downside put, serving as the protection. The other portion of that options premium will be delivered in the form of a monthly dividend to the investors. And there's two key objectives to this strategy, and that is yield enhancement and risk reduction.
And in terms of where the calls are sold and then where the puts are bought, how close do they are in terms of being at the money?
So the strategy utilizes a proprietary systematic rules-based model. So based on current market price action and current market volatility, the calls can be sold anywhere from near at the money to a few percent out of the money. And then the puts can be purchased, you know, say 5 to 10% out of the money, whereby they're still providing a fairly relevant measure of downside protection.
Okay, and you mentioned this being a systematic process. I know this is technically an actively managed ETF. Where does that active piece come into play, or is it just to give you flexibility?
No, the active piece comes in managing the risks associated with the covered call component. And when I say the risks associated, you know, the risk in a passive option strategy could be the fact that as the market changes throughout the month, you miss out on either the opportunity to close the short call option in a rising market, or you don't have the opportunity to close it out when the value of the option declines to lock in the premium and lock in those gains. So in managing the risk of the short call option, as we saw a few times this year already, in a rising market, we can close that call option, and that, in theory, is uncapping the underlying equities. So we're seeking to give the portfolio the potential to participate in further gains if that upward trend continues. So that's the risk there, is trying to minimize the impact of not being able to participate in outsized monthly moves in the NASDAQ 100.
Yeah, and I guess on that note, why use the NASDAQ 100 versus, I don't know, the S&P 500? Is it just because there's higher volatility that leads to greater options premium?
That is definitely one piece of it. The NASDAQ 100 yields less than 1% a year, but it also has this tremendous growth profile with some of the most innovative and disruptive companies, you know, that are publicly listed globally. And what this is seeking to do is, you know, deliver a yield that's right now for NUSI north of 7% compared with 70 basis points for the NASDAQ, as well as giving people, you know, the opportunity to invest in growth names that maybe for the low volatility, income-focused investor, this was off limits before. So it's really trying to bring a few different things so that it opens up an opportunity for all investors to benefit from the strategy.
As you were alluding to earlier, I think when some investors hear options caller strategy, that sounds pretty complex, right? And what I thought might be helpful is to sort of boil this down into the two main components, just in terms of maybe how this strategy differs from actually owning something like the triple Qs, the NASDAQ 100. Can you explain the difference both in terms of income and then just that risk management piece? So I guess in other words, what does the investor experience look like compared to just owning the Qs?
Sure. So if we were to look at NUSI against the Qs, there's a few things that we're really focused on. One is generating that or sourcing high current monthly income. So you're now getting a reliable, consistent income stream that is roughly seven times that of the Qs. Given the fully financed put or market hedge, we're also reducing correlation and volatility to the broader market. That was really showcased in February and March, where peak to trough was roughly a third of the drawdown of the Qs. So it comes down to enhancing the yield, reducing volatility, and downside risk mitigation are the three key benefits when comparing it to, you know, just the benchmark index.
I know this can move around, but where is the upside typically capped? You mentioned that you can remove that cap, but just high level, what does that look like?
So let's just go since the fund has been live. It only launched in December of 2019, but if we were to look at upside capture, downside capture, since the fund has been live on a calendar month basis, it's around 70% upside capture with around 40% downside capture.
Okay. And then on the income side, is it always a case that there's a net credit between selling the calls and buying the puts, or does a market environment ever cause that to flip?
There can be different market environments that could make it difficult to position and generate the same amount of a net credit on a monthly basis, but the strategy seeks to generate that net credit on a monthly basis.
Okay. So how do you see this ETF fitting in an investor portfolio? Let's just say you have an investor with a traditional 60-40 stock bond allocation. Where does something like this strategy fit?
So I view it as a hybrid. So if we looked at the 60-40 and drew the line in the sand, it would hover right over that line. And I say that because it affords investors equity exposure with less volatility in that fully financed market hedge. And it's also affording investors, you know, a way to supplement, enhance, or complement their income profile and their overall portfolio yield without onboarding a lot of the additional risks that come with either bonds or traditional equity-linked income products.
Well, you know what? You bring up a good point because obviously, especially now, yield is very difficult to come by. I mean, rates have continued to come down. There's no question. I think some investors are reaching for yield and taking that additional risk that you mentioned. What about the specific risks here? Let's say this is viewed as maybe a potential fixed income replacement. There's no free lunch, right? So what's the biggest risk with this strategy?
So with this strategy, if we were to look at some of those risks that we just mentioned, so this is seeking to, you know, reduce any of the risks that could come from duration, interest rate sensitivity. The product does not use leverage. There are some commodity-linked income strategies that you're now onboarding commodity exposure. And you're right, there isn't a free lunch. So the risks here are that you do have the equity risk associated with the NASDAQ, and you do have the risk that over time, the key risk with this product would be a slow, gradual downward bleed in the market,
mm-hmm.
where you're offsetting your income brought in, but that market hedge is still, you know, the market hasn't gone down that much. Now, we haven't really seen that over the course of history, but that would be the risk here.
And that's just because those puts that you're buying are whatever, 5-10% out of the money, right? So that potential down move before those puts come into play, that's the bigger risk there.
Absolutely.
Out of curiosity, do you see any similarities between this strategy and the defined outcome ETFs that have become so popular recently? You know, I think especially the buffer strategies that protect from sizable drawdowns, something like a 30-35% drawdowns. Do you see any similarities here?
I do. I think over the last handful of years, and especially the success with the defined outcome and the buffer ETFs is really a testament to the traction that options-based ETFs have gained in the market, and that there's a significant appetite in the marketplace for, you know, whether it be yield enhancement or downside, you know, risk mitigation. And, you know, all of these strategies bring their own independent benefits. There are some overlaps, but it's a testament to the appetite in the marketplace where people are willing to, you know, take a slightly more conservative approach, potentially give away some of the upside, but to be able to know what their downside looks like in the event of, you know, a reemergence of volatility like we saw in February, March.
No, it's really remarkable. I was visiting with ETF.com Sumeet Roy earlier, and we were talking about the defined outcome category, just the proliferation there. And, you know, a lot of those ETFs are showing up on the fastest growing ETFs list. And I look at a strategy like this, there's no question this entire sort of risk managed space is really getting the attention of investors. You know, I guess a little off topic, but as we talk about defined outcome ETFs, I'm not sure, have you followed this new ETF labeling proposal at all?
I have.
Okay, so we've talked a lot about it over the past several weeks on the podcast, and it just dawned on me, I believe your strategy would be labeled as an exchange-traded instrument under this proposal, right? ETI, it wouldn't be labeled an ETF. And so under the current proposal, the way it's written, it would be lumped in with leverage and inverse products. Do you agree with that, or do you have any other thoughts on this proposal?
So in regards to the proposal, there's pros and cons to everything. So I think one of the pros here, though, is that, you know, the emergence of options-based products, I think in the market have somewhat already been lumped in with the leveraged or the inverse products. And what this is going to do is give products that aren't leveraged, that aren't inverse, the opportunity to really stand out and showcase their benefits in the market instead of just blindly being lumped in as anything that uses options. So from that perspective, I think it's a great opportunity for, you know, NUSI or defined outcome or buffer to really educate the marketplace on not just the differences, but the benefits of how these strategies are constructed. And the only drawback to all of that is, you know, the ETF industry was kind of founded on, you know, simplifying the investment process, providing liquidity and transparency and a great investor experience. And the only fear here is that it may complicate or add some complexities to the investment selection process and trying to get everyone comfortable with what these different labels mean.
No, I think that's a good observation. I've gone back and forth on this. I think largely I'm supportive of the proposal. Interestingly, I think a product like yours or the defined outcome ETFs, I think the case could be made to break those into even another category outside of leverage and inverse ETFs, because these are really risk managed products. Whereas you look at something like a leveraged ETF, I think by and large are taking on a lot of risk, at least if you just look at the product in a vacuum. But I think you raise a good point. I mean, the more acronyms you bring into the equation, that can cause more confusion. However, on the other hand, I think that confusion might be a good thing in the sense that if investors don't understand the acronym, maybe they will do a little bit more research and actually dig under the hood of the product. So that's why I kind of flip back and forth on this. But overall, I am supportive. John, just a few minutes left. Any quick thoughts on the financial markets right now? Of course, the underlying holdings in your ETF, the NASDAQ 100, I mean, they're at all-time highs. And, you know, meanwhile, we look at the economy. I think clearly there are very real concerns out there. What do you make of the markets and sort of squaring that with the economy?
So at least for the NASDAQ, we are at, you know, at and then near all-time highs, it feels like, almost on a daily basis. The 40% move since the March lows, I think, is as incredible and jaw-dropping is that precipitous drop that we saw that started in February. And, you know, to be right back where we were in the beginning of the year with all the uncertainties that we currently find ourselves kind of mulling over, whether it be when will there be a vaccine, will there be a second wave, the job losses that came from the lockdown, you know, what does a recovery look like when, you know, they said that a recession began in February. And more important, what do, you know, how can we fundamentally price equities right now, given all of these uncertainties? And does valuation really even matter at this point? I will say that the liquidity that's in the market and the fact that we have found ourselves in this low-rate, low-yield environment for so long, it is no surprise that there are still people buying stocks. Now, as to what comes in the next 6 to 12 months, whether it be COVID, a vaccine, tensions with other large economies, and even how our own economy starts to recover and normalize in the face of the unknowns around an election are still to be, you know, uncovered. But right now, everything is pointing higher.
Well, and of course, you can add into that equation the Federal Reserve, right? We're all well aware of what they're doing. And I think handicapping risk return right now, it has become more difficult. And you talk about the move off the bottom back on March 23rd. You look at the companies that are really driving that. There are a lot of junky companies sort of leading higher. And so, you know, I think it's really difficult making heads or tails of everything right now, because you look at some of the economic data out there, unemployment, so on and so forth, look in the real estate market. I think it's tough to feel real great as we sit here today. You mentioned the uncertainty of the election. You know, on the other hand, you know, we did have a substantial down move, you know, down 35%. And so I think a bounce, you can make the case, maybe was warranted. I think it's going to be really interesting seeing what happens moving here forward. I guess a good case to have a risk managed strategy in your portfolio. John, excellent spotlight this week. Wish you continued success with this ETF. Really appreciate you joining me. Thank you.
Thank you very much for having me.
That was John Mulchan, Managing Director and Portfolio Manager with Harvest Volatility Management. That'll do it for this week's ETF Prime. If you enjoyed the podcast, we would greatly appreciate a quick review wherever you listen to the show. Also, always love hearing from you directly. You can send comments through etfprime.com. Next week, two excellent guests. I'll first be joined by Vanguard's Rich Powers. We're going to cover a bunch of different ETF topics. And then ProShares' Simeon Hyman will discuss ETFs focused on dividend growth and online retail, including one of the best performing ETFs this year. Until then, have a great week, everyone.